Okay, so welcome to the third lecture of European Integration. Today the topic is capital mobility in the context of the integration process as we've tried to describe it until now in terms of this this common framework we discussed in the first two lectures. And I'm going to talk about financial markets at the as a mechanism that enables capital mobility. We won't go into too much detail this time, but next in the coming lectures, we'll discuss it in more detail, especially in the second part of the course, we talk about financial aspects of monetary integration. Today, we'll talk about several things. We'll review last time's lecture. We'll actually make some last remarks on the solo model and a few words of warning to those who would like to use it. We've made an implicit assumption which needs to be talked about directly. That's the assumption that both regions in this bilateral regional convergence scenario actually have the same production function. And I'll show you that even in the case of Germany, where the best of all possible preconditions were met, East Germany still hasn't reached West German levels of total factor productivity. And this is kind of a warning. So be careful when you apply this tool to think about regional integration. The assumption that regions have the same production function or the same efficiency of resource conversion from labor and capital into resource, into productive output, or into output that we can consume and invest, is a leap of faith. And I'll show you how you can actually use that in your own work when you compare regions and countries, whether countries have the similar levels of what we call total factor productivity. This is an important point that was made in the Macro 1 lecture when I taught it, but it kind of got buried under a lot of other growth information, and it usually appears on the final exam in Macro 1. It's very useful for those who want to go do applied work and think about companies or countries, the use of the solo residual analysis, and I'll teach you something new today en passant called the Denison Hall-Jones decomposition. You didn't see that in Macro 1, so you'll learn something new today. We'll talk mostly about capital mobility, okay? The idea here is that capital moves across boundaries. It doesn't have to be created in the period. So we're not talking about savings as an accretion to the capital stock. We're actually talking about literally moving productive equipment, productive facilities across regional boundaries. Now in the end, in the limit, this is not always possible. So a factory that was built in Frankfurt Oder can't be physically picked up and moved, but sometimes it can. So several years ago, we actually went to Schwedt and looked at a factory that was involved in the reprocessing of paper, which the Germans do quite well, sort of the recycling of paper. In fact, if you buy the Spiegel, it's usually printed on 100% recycled paper, so you feel good about that. Well, in Schwedt, there's a factory that actually does that. And that factory was transplanted from Bavaria, the Leipa plant, to Schwedt. Literally, they put it on a rail and, you know, on cars and sent it to Eastern Germany. So this is an example where capital, even that type of productive capital, can actually be moved. But generally, think about construction equipment. It's very easy to move cranes across regional boundaries, trucks, automotive equipment that's mobile, train, rolling stock. All these things are kind of extreme forms of capital mobility. But also, you can allow a building to depreciate and cover the funds that you set aside for depreciation that you would have set aside to fix that building, to repair it, keep to maintain it, and invest those funds elsewhere. So, okay, so this, the capital can be mobile at very different levels of analysis. So we'll talk about this abstractly. The notion that capital can move much more quickly than the solo model would predict if each household were accumulating capital by deferred consumption. We'll talk about theory and practice. Theory, of course, is fairly straightforward. The practice is interesting because you can, in the European context, you can observe several examples of where capital mobility has proceeded very fast and maybe not so fast. Finally, I'll talk about the European financial and unified capital market. If you think of there's recent initiatives beyond the banking union to actually create a capital markets union There's quite a bit of press revolving around some suggestions, some proposals that have been made. I won't talk in too much detail about it, but it's clear that capital markets serve several functions, not just moving investment resources from one region to another, but also risk allocation, reallocation, risk diversification. And we'll talk about that briefly, but most of that will be material for the second half of this course. And I'll mention some of the risks of too much capital mobility. Okay, last time we basically looked at integration in a homegrown context. So thinking of the solo model, nations become more like each other, become more integrated in efficiency or an equity criterion by accumulating capital that they basically provide themselves. Okay, and this is a long, drawn-out process. It takes a long time. We saw from the solo model with and without technical change that this process can take a long time. It can take, the 2% convergence rate, it takes about 35 years for a region to close half of the gap to some leading region. And despite that terribly pessimistic outlook, it turns out to be the case. That tends to be the benchmark case, even for states of the United States. These things happen very slowly. We've seen in the German case that convergence occurred much more quickly, at least in the initial years. But if you take the longer horizon, or if you take the most recent years, actually East Germany has really slowed down to a standstill. The gap is pretty much stabilized. So maybe Robert Barrow was right after all in a very long horizon, but capital accumulation we'll see and labor mobility can actually change those 2% predictions that we are prone to make. Okay, we did some comparative statics analysis using the solo model. This is fairly basic stuff for macro one, macro two, but useful. And the 2% rule I mentioned already, and we had some examples. So I'd like to go back into the final discussion of convergence using the mechanism of economic growth and qualify it, make some restrictive remarks that we want to be careful that this always occurs everywhere and at the same rate. The most important assumption you can make is that in this Edgeworth analysis, this Edgeworth factor allocation box, is that the production function that both regions have is the same. Okay, and that's a very strong assumption. The case of Germany, which is probably the best of all possible worlds, you know, the German unification imposed a common rule of law, common set of legal institutions, but also common technology. The language is already there, the culture was there. There's really no excuse to expect that total factor productivity in the East would not converge to that of the West. But it turns out that if you look at the data, East German productivity remains about 75 to 80% of West German levels on a per hour basis. Okay, and it's been stuck there for the past 10, possibly 15 years. You know, we've had unification now for 25 years, going on 25 years. So the economic process seems to have come to a standstill. And that kind of casts a little bit of doubt on my Edgeworth box analysis, because that would imply that the diagonal is not the efficient allocation of capital and labor. Okay, so again, Barrow predicted 35 years to close half of the gap. That certainly didn't happen. The first part of the convergence episode was quite optimistic. I think the gaps shrank at the rate of about 4 to 5% during that first 10 years. And after then, it has slowed down, and we seem to be sort of stabilized. And it turns out the capital intensity is even higher in some sectors in East Germany. It's kind of interesting. So the diagonal of our Edgeworth box in factor allocation space tells us that efficient points are achieved along the diagonal when East and West have the same capital labor ratio. We'll talk about that again today. But that's only true if they have the same production function. So be careful. And I'll tell you how you want to check that out. If you want to do some analysis on your own, if you go work for a consultancy somewhere, there are two really easy ways to check to see if regions or countries have achieved the same level of total factor productivity. Well, what do I mean by that? I mean, if you put the same capital and labor to work in both regions, you get pretty much the same output, the same GDP per capita, the same potential for creating and redistributing wealth. Okay? And if you know the numbers, GDP per capita in East Germany, per capita, not per hour, but per capita, remains about 70 to 75% of West German levels. So it's even worse because East Germans have higher unemployment rates. A lot of human resources are not fully allocated and fully utilized. Well, here are two ways to look at this question. One is the one that you've already learned in Macro 1. That's the solo decomposition, which is a way of checking to see if the same increments to capital and labor lead to the same increments in output. Okay? And I'll give you a formula for that. I'm going to teach you something new today, which is the Hall-Jones variation. Okay, it's actually associated with Dennison, who wrote about this about 50 years ago, but Hall and Jones get the credit because they wrote a paper in the Quarterly Journal of Economics in 1999 that sort of put it all together. This is a way of comparing TFP, total factor productivity, across space at a point in time. Because you have a benchmark country like the United States or Germany, and you compare other regions and countries in the world by looking at the differentials in capital and labor and other inputs. This is the solo decomposition that you learned and learned to love when you took Macro 1. Okay, so we have basically a log linearization of the change of output in a production function that involves capital and labor, K and L respectively, and basically this delta A over A, delta A sub T, subscript T divided by A in T, is the rate of growth in total factor productivity over that period. That's a definition. It's an identity. It's a construct. So we write basically TFP growth as the difference between observable output growth and some weighted average of the inputs that we can also measure. We can measure capital input and we can measure labor input. So if you learn anything in this course that you didn't learn in Macro 1, you can learn this again because it's a very useful construct. You can use this to not just to compare the performance of regions and countries, you can use it to look at firms. You can actually use it in business studies to look at the efficiency of factories. Because this need not be just two factors, you can have many factors. You just need an assumption of constant returns to scale, and you can do a similar so-called solo decomposition. It's an attribution of observable growth to things that we can observe and things we can't observe. So the notion is that this delta A over A captures the shift of the production function over the period. And the notion is that every period we're getting better at what we do. We're learning by doing, we're gathering new information, rationalizing production processes and the like. So you've seen this before. I'd like to modify this slightly because this is what we all know that you know, TFP is kind of explains about 50% of all well-being or increases in GDP across the world. Most of what we observe in the world is actually just people getting more efficient at using labor and capital. Okay, which leads me to believe that maybe it's more than just efficiency. It also might be legal institutions, rule of law, lack of corruption. Okay, it could also involve things like human capital that we don't have here explicitly, infrastructure. All these things could be packed into this solo residual, as it's called. Now, this is a temporal measure. So you can take data and you can construct for any country you like or any region you like a series that would correspond to this number, and you can plot it so you can see what's happening with TFP. So if you understood what I said about East Germany, you'll understand that East Germany's TFP growth has petered out. It's slowed down. It started off very strong in the 1990s, and then it started to slow down around 2000. And that's the mystery. Why is that? And you'd expect the East Germans to be just as good at everything as the West Germans are. What's lacking? That's a really interesting question that European integration has to grapple with because it's not just about Germany. It's about Paris and the outskirts of Paris or the northern part of France and the southeast of France. Why are they developing differently at different rates? Spain has the same issue. Northern Spain is very productive, cutting edge. Southern Spain is very agricultural and no one wants to move factories down there. So these are all issues that one has to think about. So here's the advanced version, if you like, of this, or a modified version of the solo decomposition. We can actually use the thing to explain per capita growth and decompose it into unobservable total factor productivity, growth in the capital stock per capita, and change in the utilization of labor as a fraction of the total population. So this is like the employment rate. So you can get a little bit of extra growth, ceteris paribus, just by putting more people into the labor force and putting them to work. It doesn't help if you put them the labor force and they don't work. So Sweden, for example, produces more GDP per capita than Germany does because women work big time. Germany is still kind of working on it. Italy is even less so. Okay, so all these things are worth thinking about. And of course, it depends on whether you use hours or bodies to measure labor input. So you have the same principle. Now here's a new one for you. This is the so-called Denison Hall-Jones decomposition. Some people call it the Hall-Jones decomposition. Here the idea is you take a benchmark region at a point in time, and you ask, okay, how far is this country, assuming that they have the same production technology, if they had it, then per capita output should deviate only because we're using more or less capital per head, okay? Well, it turns out that's not true. If production functions are different, all of the difference that remains will be a residual, sort of like a solo residual, but it's a spatial residual, okay? So you can calculate that just by getting a benchmark country like the United States or West Germany and using that as the Y star, K star, L star, the benchmark. And what is the percentage deviation of our region or our country from that? And then what's left over would be a measure of how far our production functions are away from each other. Okay, so you can do this with Germany. I did this for East-West Germany just to give you an idea. So in 2000, the gap of per capita GDP of the East with the West was about a third. Okay, so that was that was actually coming from where they came from. That was quite a bit of progress. But by 2008, the number had not moved very much. Okay, so over almost a decade, just before the financial crisis hit, nothing had changed very much, maybe 4%. Some might consider that a lot, but the optimistic people and looked at East Germany would have thought that's a bit weak. You can see that gap was closed to a large extent by closing the capital gap. Okay, so in East Germany, there's more and more productive equipment. In the West, investment slowed down, and here not much changed at all. So the contribution of the fraction of people in work didn't change. So if you fill in the question marks, you see that the gap of TFP, as estimated using this technique, hasn't changed at all. Okay, you can do this. You can repeat this experiment for the most recent data. I did it on the train coming in. It's maybe 1 or 2 percentage points better. So this is a very, very stubborn issue, right? TFP in East Germany relative to the West is just not changing very much. So it behooves us to ask the question, what is causing this difference and why is it so persistent? And there are lots of interesting research projects out there to associate it with various things like infrastructure. But you know, you think about Eastern Germany, they've got great infrastructure. Is it education? No, the Eastern Germans have pretty good education. Is it demographics? Could be. A lot of young people left East Germany, right? A lot of population was lost in the first decade after unification. A lot of young people left, and the young people tend to be the ones that are dynamic and moving things forward, starting new companies. It's an open question, but all these explanations don't seem to cut it. The one that seems to cut it, probably at the moment, is that firms' headquarters tend to be located in the West. So this is another aspect of European integration that probably needs to be discussed, which is the urbanization and the industrialization that goes along with that. Also the post-industrialization, dynamic service economy like you have in Munich or in Hamburg is very hard to observe even in Berlin. Okay, in Berlin, I would even put as sort of a hybrid between West and East Germany. Okay, so this is a very important research topic and deserves a lot of tension. So let's go to the topic of today's lecture, which is capital mobility. Okay, so I'm going to talk about this primarily as an alternative to homegrown capital accumulation. You know, we already saw that underdeveloped regions can improve their GDP per capita and their income distribution, they can improve their social services, they can improve all sorts of things by developing, and developing by investing in physical capital. If you go for the solo route, it takes a long time, so you're going to have to be very patient. We've seen that from the United States, where there is pretty much perfect capital mobility across the U.S. states, at least in most recent decades. It still takes a long time for the regions to converge. So the idea would be to bring in capital from the outside. We call this foreign direct investment, although there's a bit of a misnomer in the data. People refer to foreign direct investment as the stock of capital. And you know, in our language, investment is the flow. Okay, so what I'm thinking about is the change in FDI positions over time. That's what I'm talking about. The ownership of productive capital, not buying real estate. If you talk to a person what investment means, who's in the financial sector, they usually think of any time when I pay money for an asset. That's not what I'm talking about. In economics, we're talking about the creation of new production facilities, the means of production, in a broad sense. It doesn't have to be a factory. It can be a truck or a railroad car. It can be a highway. It can be a hospital. All these things that create the ability to generate more value added. Okay, so in the OECD, if you want to look this up for your region or country or your favorite area of interest, you want to look for the gross domestic capital formation. Okay, so this is what we would call I in the GDP accounts. It's gross, meaning that it's replacing some depreciation that's already occurred. Okay, so if you do a research paper, you do your bachelor thesis on this, please get this right. Okay. Because your advanced, mature macro and microeconomists. This implies that FDI is different from homegrown capital because the people who own it are not the people who live in the country or in the region. Okay, so a lot of the capital in East Germany that you observe belongs to West Germans or belongs to French people. Okay, now is that bad? No, because if you didn't have it, you wouldn't have anything to work with. Okay, so there's obviously going to be an issue of income from that capital, whether it flows to the worker or to the capitalist. And you might care whether the capitalist is living in the region or not, but really you shouldn't. From an efficiency perspective, it doesn't matter. Okay, and there's no reason to, in a world like this, do Bavarians care if people from Baden-Württemberg bring money over and build a building? Or some insurance company from Frankfurt invests in northern Germany? No. Okay? So European, the mentality has to change because Europeans aren't quite ready to accept that yet. There are already lots of different discussions. I remember when Hungary joined the European Union, there was a lot of discussion whether it was fair or correct that Hungarian banks would be bought by, and they were ultimately bought by Western European companies. The same discussion here in Poland. When this discussion has died, then you know that European integration has made a step forward. Okay, because people should realize, in a market economy, what's important is whether the people who are immobile and working in the region have a lot of capital to work with, a lot of equipment that makes them productive or not. But still, you have to be aware that this makes a difference between whether we measure GDP, which is the value added created in the region, or GNI, which is a measure of income accruing to those people who live in the region. And the biggest difference you'll see in a second is with Ireland. Ireland has benefited from huge capital inflows from the United States, from Germany, from Great Britain, but at the expense of having a very large difference between gross domestic product and gross national income. Now, the Irish people have learned how to live with that, okay, because the alternative is not very attractive. Okay, so in theory, we're talking about the same neoclassical theory that drives all our thoughts about this Edgeworth allocation problem, how we allocate capital and labor across two regions. And again, this is generalizable to many regions. It's very difficult to put in a diagram. That's why we do two regions. The most important item here is the marginal product of capital. The marginal product of capital is the additional output that is induced in an efficient environment when firms put it to use in one region versus another. And because we've assumed constant returns to scale, the marginal product of capital is pretty much a function of the capital labor ratio. So going back to the Edgeworth allocation problem, the region that has the high little k will be the one that has the low marginal product of capital. They have a lot of capital per worker. And the capital poor region will be the one that actually has a high marginal product of capital. So this is the market will basically gravitate towards solving that problem through capital mobility. Okay, so you should understand why that's the case. We already discussed the concavity of the intensive form of the production function last week. Okay, so the more little k you've got, you're still producing more, but the marginal contribution of that extra capital per capita or per worker is less than in the comparable region that is capital poor. So if you have a common technology and you have a single output, this construct of a single output, which we call GDP, then it makes sense to reallocate capital across regions. Okay, so that's the driving force in this picture. So all things equal, we'd expect countries that are capital rich to be exporting capital to regions that are capital poor. So again, think of Germany. Germany is capital rich. I don't care how smart you are, you can't convince me that's not true. Okay, the capital output ratio, the capital labor ratio in Germany is one of the highest in the industrialized world, even today, even after unification, especially in southern Western Germany. Okay, so that means that at the margin, additional investment projects may have limited productivity compared with, say, moving capital to Poland. And this explains my example, why Leipa moved their paper processing plant from Bavaria to Schwedt and made a lot of money doing so, because they were able to employ relatively inexpensive labor at the time and, again, make a very large contribution to productivity in the region. Okay, so using the Poland-Finland allocation problem, you can think of this as either a closed system where the Edgeworth box is closed, nothing comes in from outside, okay, and nothing's coming in from inside through domestic economic growth. We're talking about a very short-term allocation. The derivative with respect to time, or the absolute differential of little k, is equal to the minus of the differential of k with respect to the other region. So if k star is the one region, k is the one we're looking at, then these are exactly equal. This is a zero-sum game, and yet it has efficiency gains. Okay, so efficiency is improved. You know, we may close a factory here and move it to Poland, or the Finns may close a factory and move it to Poland, but that's a gain actually for the region. And you could organize a compensation scheme that would compensate all the losers in Finland, because the region as a whole is better off. That's an important factor. Of course, it's flowing from a bunch of assumptions we made, but these are very robust assumptions. One of them is the constant returns to scale. If you don't believe in constant returns to scale, we'll have some issues to talk about. But I think for a large region, this is not an issue. Okay? So, you know, we can basically ask this question. Since we know that little k moves, you can just do the calculus. I'm not going to do it for you. It's quite easy to demonstrate that as the capital-labor ratio rises, the marginal product of capital falls in the receiving region, where the marginal product of capital is higher, and the marginal capital product of capital in the sending region actually rises. So the capital-rich region will actually observe an increase in profitability as capital migrates. Okay, so this sounds a bit paradoxical, but it's probably true. I mean, if you think about the implications of moving that factory, it means one less factory in Bavaria to serve that market. Okay, so be aware, I'm just showing this stuff very quickly, be aware that you realize that the marginal product of capital in a constant returns to scale world is only a function of the ratio. Okay, so this last expression is very important. I can ignore I can basically ignore the size of this region. All right, so, you know, this is something I would ask you to do in the section. You know, the primary assumption is that concavity of the production function. The second one is that capital is remunerated at the marginal product, so it's a competitive and not a monopsonistic capital market. And therefore, you can derive the effect of increasing capital intensity on the rate of return just by taking the derivative of the first order condition for the company or for the firm that's using capital. Okay, so here's the picture. This is clear that you should be able to figure this out. The endowment, the original endowment is basically in point E. Capital mobility, freezing labor mobility would mean a vertical movement downwards. So you can see that the angle that E prime forms with the origin from the finished perspective is closer than it was at the original point to the angle formed by Poland's endowment formed by the point of the angle from the upper right part of this diagram. So these two angles will come closer and closer. This one and this one will become closer and closer as we proceed with capital integration. This process will come to an end, assuming constant returns to scale and common production technologies at point double E. Now, of course, at the same time, labor mobility may happen. That's the next week's subject. So we'll come back to that. But we should be clear that there are all sorts of things going on at the same time. It's not just about capital mobility. So in the textbook that you're using, there's emphasis of the so-called gains from integration, which can be understood in two ways. One is that the marginal product changes. That's what we've captured. The other is the production function may shift. So be careful when you think about this. This means that there's some sort of transfer of information or some convergence of the production function that is implied by the transfer of productive resources. We've shut that down. That doesn't occur in our setup. Okay, so we're actually looking at a movement across the frontier. There's another thing you should think about, which is the increase in capital coming from a third region, coming from, say, France. France could invest in Poland without impinging on the Finnish activity or the Finnish willingness to invest in their own region. And this also assumes basically, and it's a very important assumption, that when you open up the system, the angle formed by the endowment from the Finnish perspective is actually very close to the world rate of interest. So the marginal product of capital in Finland is already kind of at where it should be. If you think of R star as being the world interest rate, that would mean that there's really no reason for the Finns to move capital abroad. They can get a higher return, but they're just going to be creating space for other investors. And that actually happens. Sometimes capital gets shuffled around a little bit. But in effect, the angle formed by E with the horizontal axis for Finland is actually appropriate. So what's going to happen is the Edgeworth-Box is going to rise, it's going to expand, not because of domestic capital accumulation, but because of reallocation of capital from some third country. Okay? And that process comes to a rest when basically the angle formed by this new line, this new diagonal, is appropriate or corresponds to the capital labor ratio that a third country would expect using the same technology. Okay, so I've already talked about all the preconditions that we're assuming. One of the things I talked about in my little excursion, my little sort of digression about total factor productivity, is not just about infrastructure, it's not just about human capital, it's about the legal framework, rule of law, lack of corruption, or the same levels of corruption. Corruption is a big problem around the world. It's one reason the developing world cannot develop, because it's like a tax. So no one's going to bring their capital to a country when, you know, they're going to get shaken down the next day after the factory is built. Right, so this is a common problem. This is something that Europe has to deal with the new accession countries. I won't mention any. But it's certainly an implicit assumption that Part of what goes into this TFP, or this total factor productivity, and the assumption of a common diagonal, common angle at efficient allocation of capital, is that this legal framework is the same. Okay, so that's one. This is one way of thinking about the Edgeworth box. Okay, so let's do this really quickly. This is kind of a rerun. So again, we're talking about the convergence of these two angles, which is basically, it's based on the premise that we actually have a common set of rules of law. So you can imagine if it were the case that in Poland you have to, you know, you have to sort of grease the wheels, as it were, then it would mean that the actual rate of return on capital in Poland has to be, before the tax, has to be higher than it would be in Finland. So one of the most important aspects of the European integration project is actually getting a common playing field across these regions. The nice thing about having a common national framework is that by construction it's equally applied. Okay, so. All right, so I, excuse me, I talked about this already. We're talking about gains from integration can be thought of as, first off, just the allocation effect. You can also think of a transfer technology effect. In fact, you can even talk about transfer of institutions. So often it's the case, if Nokia goes to Romania, they may actually impose a whole set of conditions on the local government. You might think of this as cleaning up the situation or establishing some sort of common framework of discussion. But this can also lead to an increase in productivity. So it can also be a productive feature. So let's differentiate these two diagrams quickly. This is what happens if you have the same production function. This is what I was talking about and what I was trying to describe in our Edgeworth diagram. Basically, both countries have the same production function, and they're both starting at fairly extremely different capital labor, capital per capita endowments, and they're going to meet somewhere in between depending on the rapidity of the process and the concavity of the production function. That's going to determine the resting point between the two regions. However, if there's an implicit transfer of technology involved, there'll be two effects. You might even add onto this a gains from trade effect, but let's just keep it simple. This is taken from Baldwin and Wiplow's. You can see that there's an extra kick. The production function increases, and there'll be an additional amount of capital accumulation, either imported or homegrown, which will be induced by the convergence of technologies across those two regions. Okay, so you can see there's a lot of interesting aspects, and it's not really, it's a bit artificial to divide this into the pure mobility effect and talk about TFP as if it were a separate object. Actually, in practice, these are all very, very similar and related. In the case of East Germany, it's probably the best example. We'll get to it in a second. I'm going to give a whole list of applications of these ideas. The most important, I think, benchmark for us is looking at the whole world. How mobile is capital across national boundaries? And think of this as the game to beat. If you want to have European integration, can Europe do better as a union compared to what happens anyway between Argentina and Mexico and the United States and Russia, for example? We know there's capital mobility between those countries. Okay? I'm going to talk about the East-West German extreme. It's the other extreme. You have a common country, so no one's asking Europe to get rid of national identities or national governments, but one could certainly ask what would happen, and the answer is what would happen if Europe unified the way Germany unified in 1990. Right? It really wasn't even a unification. It was more like a leveraged buyout. I mean, East Germany was taken over by West Germany. East Germans didn't have much to say about the laws. They were just adopting the West German constitution. But that's a common framework. So that's the other extreme. And everything in between, we can talk about small regional national economy like Ireland. We can talk about the accession countries in Eastern Europe, and we'll do these in sequence. Okay, so in the last half hour, the next 30 to 35 minutes, I'll talk about these in detail. So my favorite kickoff is the Feldstein-Horioka puzzle. So a long time ago, Martin Feldstein, a professor at Harvard, and his graduate student, Charles Horioka, pointed out that there was a puzzle. The puzzle is that basically savings and investment rates in international context are actually quite highly correlated. Now, why is that a puzzle? See if anybody out there knows why that's a puzzle. Take 150 countries, compute the savings rate in 2010 and the investment rate in 2010. And it turns out that they're highly correlated across countries. If capital is mobile, it shouldn't matter where the savings is done. The capital should go to where the investment projects are. So there's no a priori theoretical reason to think that the correlation of savings rates, remember what savings is? Savings is deferred consumption. Investment is the actual construction of productive equipment. There's no reason to think that those should be highly correlated. There's no reason that a country that saves a lot should invest a lot, because they could take their savings and move it to South Africa or to Brazil or wherever else the rate of return on capital is high. Okay, so that's the theory. Just again, think about my Edgeworth situation. Capital should move to the places where capital is scarce and to places where capital is most productive. So right now we know in India needs infrastructure. I read about that this morning. India has huge infrastructure gaps. They estimate that 40% of all Indian produce is lost because they don't have decent roads and transportation facilities and storage facilities. Imagine that, 40% of their food production is just lost. That's really inefficient. We waste a lot of food in restaurants because we don't eat it and it gets thrown away, but this is ridiculous, okay? The same thing is true for a lot of other things that go on in India. There are not enough roads, there's not enough public transportation, a lot of time gets wasted, okay? So there must be a high return, a social return to investing in India, but for some reason, the only people that invest in India are the Indians in this grand scheme of things. And Robert Lucas put it very, very clearly. At the scarcity that we observe, there should be no direct investment in Germany in its own economy. Everything should be moving down there. Okay, so that's the puzzle. Because I'm going to show you the puzzle is that the correlation of savings across nations is positive. So you really have to do some mental gymnastics to explain that. It's possible. But the a priori expectation would be that the correlation is probably zero. If the distribution of productive opportunities is random across the world, and the distribution of savings propensities is random, there's no reason those should be positively correlated, unless capital were not mobile, unless there were some obstructions or some reasons that people are reluctant to take their money out of the country. Okay? Therefore, if India doesn't have capital formation, it's probably because India's not saving very much. China has a savings rate of probably over 40% right now, and that's financing their 40% investment rate. So that's the Feldstein-Horioka puzzle. Okay, and if you still don't understand this, think about the fundamental identity of macro. The fundamental identity of macro is C plus I plus G plus X minus Z, or Z equals Y. And if you manipulate that one time, you get this relationship. S minus I, that's the net savings of the private sector. T minus G is the net saving of the government. Has to be equal by definition, by bookkeeping, equal to the surplus of that country with the rest of the world. Okay, so if our households are saving, over what they're investing and the government saving over what they're investing, the country has to be saving vis-a-vis the rest of the world. That's an identity. Okay, so if a country, you know, if a country has a big deficit on the government account and the locals are saving lots, it can actually be the case that the current account is equal to zero. But generally that's not the case. So generally, you know, countries that save a lot tend to invest a lot. So that's implying basically that this X minus Z, this current account, is not as movable, probably because anytime you have a current account deficit, it means that other countries are lending to you, and maybe they don't trust you. I mean, they'll give you a little bit, especially if you offer collateral. You know, but if you're a country like Greece, you don't have a great reputation right now, right? Or even Ireland or Spain, Argentina, it's hard for these countries to borrow. They've already kind of burned their reputation. So the Feldstein-Horioka puzzle is basically saying that overall, if your households want to save a lot, they're going to end up getting stuck at home because they're reluctant to take it abroad, all things equal. Okay, so here's the data. In case you're interested, there's a lot of data that supports this. Okay, so we basically calculated for each country over the period 1960 to 2010, the correlation per year of savings and investment rates. So, okay, so Australia, the number is 0.95. So in Australia has a, you know, the years they have a high savings rate, there's a lot of investment in Australia and vice versa. Austria, it's less. Austria is a smaller country, also geographically speaking. The United States is quite high. Japan is extremely high. And this is over the entire period, so it's kind of unfair. Maybe in the 1960s, capital was immobile, and now we have this modern, integrated global financial market. Maybe it's easier to move capital. Okay, so we have to test that. But first, just let that sink in. The Horioka puzzle is basically this average correlation is 0.5. The only way you can make that argument is that you make the argument that investment opportunities are perfectly correlated across regions, and therefore, no matter where you invest, it's a good investment. But it still doesn't explain countries that are very poor still can't run current account deficits to accumulate capital at the rate that we think as objective observers should be the case. So this is a real puzzle. Okay, so part two is basically, let's look at the correlation over time. So this is a challenge to see if you're listening to me and not texting with friends. Or even understanding what I'm talking about. But this is an important point. What I did before was each country for itself correlating, again, this is basic statistics, correlation per country of an investment and a savings rate. Now I'm going to take a slice in each period. I'm going to look across the world in a single year, or here an interval of 5 years to smooth things out a little bit, and I'm going to take a moving average of those correlations across the world. Okay, so this is kind of more directly asking the question, if a country is running it, you know, needs capital today, can it get it from somewhere else? Okay, so this is, you can see that in 1960 to 65, the average correlation across the world, not within a country, but across the world, was greater than 0.8. That's pretty high. Okay, so you can imagine the reason I'm doing this is because it's an interesting fact, okay, but because it's gone down. It's fallen. So the globalization of capital markets has actually led to an attenuation of the Feldstein-Horioka puzzle. Okay, so that's an important fact. There's no question that this correlation has fallen, and it seems to have a bit of a wave feature to it, but the trend is definitely downward. After the financial crisis, people became a bit more nervous and not necessarily nationalistic, but more prone to go back and invest at home because they're scared. So it's not surprising that the financial crisis was associated with a rise in that number. But you know, if you think about the fact that a lot of American mortgages are financed implicitly by Europeans, Norwegians are investing their money in Brazil, this is much more the case than it was 50 years ago. Okay, so that's the good news. Integration of capital markets is pushing us towards more capital mobility. Take the most extreme situation, you impose the same system, Did it work the way it should? What kind of economic integration can we observe attributed to capital mobility? So let's look at German unification. At the outset of unification episode, the capital stock in East Germany was about 10% of the West German level per capita. This is an estimate because we really don't know. There was no market for East German capital in 1990. You could send McKinsey around and let them check it out, make an estimate. But you could see by the difficulties that the Treuhandanstalt had to sell the East German capital stock, it probably wasn't worth very much. Okay? A lot of investment was needed. Okay? Same time, East Germans had an almost identical endowment of education and training. I mean, you can see the data. It's quite, in some areas, the East Germans had more people trained in certain skill classifications. Legal, political barriers were gone. And it turned out that about 1.2 trillion euros was moved across the boundary. In other words, in East Germany, about 1.2 trillion euros was invested. This is about dated about 2010. So this is a large amount of capital. Remember, the GDP of Germany is about 2.4 trillion euros. That's quite a bit of resources that were moved over the past 20, 25 years. Okay, so that's an amazing instance or case of capital mobility at its extreme. Okay, so these are the classic ways of measuring. We can't really measure capital mobility. You don't have a meter counting the billions of euros that are crossing the border. All you can do is measure what's happening en place, right, for Ort. And you can see that these investment rates are quite high. So these are investment rates as a percentage of GDP. The solid line is the structural investment rate in the East. The dotted line, the dotted blue line is the rate of equipment investment in the East. So you can see these are quite different. So those of you who remember or have parents who talked about this, one of the big complaints in the 1990s was that in every street corner in East Germany, they were building a new building, a new apartment building or a house. But in terms of investing in jobs besides construction, investing in sustainable workplaces, it's kind of mediocre. The performance isn't that great. I mean, this is not bad, but you know, since 2000, it's pretty much converged. There's still a lot of real estate investment in Eastern Germany. Okay, a lot of this is because of tax advantages, accelerated depreciation, and the like. So there has been some criticism, but this is a huge amount of resources that flowed. And you might say, well, the East Germans needed that. They needed houses. The housing stock was dilapidated. But you always, I mean, economics is about alternatives. The alternative might have been creating more sustainable production in Eastern Germany. But of course, the markets have to do that. The government can't dictate it. It has to create the incentives or the conditions that make it more attractive. So this, if you like, this is the Edgeworth-Box approach. So each one of those sets of arrows represents one Bundesland. In addition, we have the average of East Germany in the upper right corner. So you can see West Germany. So West Germany is larger, that's clear, but it also has, on average, a higher capital labor ratio still. But you can see that most of the new states have made amazing progress. Okay, so K over L is moving. In fact, in some industries, it's estimated that East German capital intensity is actually higher than it is in the West. Maybe it's because of the new technologies, more capital intensive. So here's Berlin. Berlin has actually grown a little bit. Growth in the absolute sense would mean moving to the northeast. But moving towards the diagonal represents some sort of common tendency we call efficiency. So clearly, Saxony has reached now the level that West Germany had in the beginning of the episode in 1995. So it's obviously a process that's taking time. And it's also refreshing to see that employment, again, is increasing finally, after 15 years of extreme pessimism by some of my colleagues, that East Germany would disappear, turn into a national park, this has not taken place. Okay, so if you look at the data, you can see that up until 2011, that's the most recent data we can actually get, you can see this overactivity investment in structures as opposed to investment in equipment. Okay, so equipment means giving a worker better, more equipment to work with. Structures means giving her or him a house to live in. Okay, so the trade-off is quite clear. This huge disparity in terms of what was done in that area, especially in the first 10 years. You've seen this already. Okay, so let's talk about another example of European integration by means of capital mobility. Ireland is a very interesting country. This raises a lot of other questions about policy. I'll just say this, if I can't get to it at the end. There have been very loud voices of criticism of Ireland because of its success may have been achieved to some extent by making it more attractive to invest in Ireland at the expense of other European regions. Okay? Everybody could say, well, that's just playing the game, right? You cut your corporate tax rate, you make it attractive for German companies to move their operations to Ireland, and maybe a few factories get closed here, so what? That's not the same thing as the argument I made before with the Edgeworth-Box, because the Edgeworth-Box assumes that everyone has the same playing field. But depending on where you pay tax, it may indeed be the case that the rate of return on capital after tax is quite different across regions. Okay, so you know, I don't want to color your opinion on this, but Ireland's success may not completely be due to the processes I've been describing. It's probably a mix between some serious economic development, we'll see it in a second, it's very impressive, and some, you know, beggar thy neighbor at the expense of other countries. The problem is that countries like France and to some extent even Germany have used this as an excuse to yell at Ireland and criticize Ireland for being such a success. So it's always this question, you know, what are the motivations of these people when they make these statements? You can tell my motivations are completely harmless because I'm not Irish, okay? I have a couple of friends that live there, but that's about it, okay? So the Irish success story means that since 1990, there's been an amazing amount of economic growth. Even after the crash of 2008, that country has managed to increase its GDP per capita beyond that of France, which is pretty impressive, even after the crash. And now Ireland is growing again, so as a success story, there is no denying that this is sustainable economic success. Okay? This was done with a backdrop of substantial FDI activity in this country. Okay, so the stock of FDI in 1990 was about 2% of GDP, and by 2001, it was about 27%. It's now estimated to be over 30%. Okay? And this is, again, a lot of companies have withdrawn from Ireland because of the crisis, but actually since the recovery, companies are moving back into that country. Remember, FDI is not the same thing as the capital formation I'm talking about because, first, it's a stock, and secondly, it's ownership. So if an American company goes to Ireland or a German company goes to Ireland and purchases a factory that exists already, that is merely a transfer of assets, asset ownership. It does not mean that Ireland is more productive. Necessarily. Maybe the new owner will go in there and clean house, kick out a few people, reorganize the production process, but it does not mean, per se, that Ireland has necessarily more capital in our sense. Okay? This boom was probably not sustainable for several reasons. One is that much of the investment, especially after 2000, was in the property market, building buildings, office buildings, apartments, houses. Okay? Some of that clearly reflects the demand by Irish households that are wealthier for more housing services, and that's completely rational, completely justifiable. But a lot of it was speculative. Some of the speculation was led by European institutions, German banks at the spearhead of this. So, you know, it's not like the Irish did this all by themselves. This is clearly, it takes two to tango in this financial world. Okay? All that notwithstanding, it's still quite trivial to say that Ireland had a great growth run, and I'm going to show you what they did. So this is normalizing GDP per capita on France. Okay, so you can see the two countries, and I put the Netherlands there because the Netherlands has had sort of a little bit of a miracle of their own since the 1980s, but it's not quite as impressive. I mean, Ireland was coming from literally being something like the poor man of Europe in 1980. Starting in 1990, after a sequence of reforms, but also just opening up to FDI, the Irish economy grew quite fast. So it moved from 60% of GDP per capita in France to at the top being at 140%, which is probably completely overdrawn. A lot of that was construction activity going into GDP, which was not sustainable. But in the meantime, this blue curve has turned around. So France is actually ahead of the, you know, may have a good reason to complain because they've been sort of left in the dust by this Celtic or this Celtic tiger, if you like. You can see that's done basically on the basis of investment, not necessarily investment from abroad, but just investment rates in general. So since 1980, you can see this the difference between this blue line and the two, well, the brown and the green aquamarine line is quite substantial. And this big crash reflects exactly the crash of the financial markets and the concomitant collapse of construction activity in Ireland. But this has again been reversed. And the integral, or the area under this curve, as a difference to the other two curves, can be thought of as the gain in physical productive capital, even if it is housing stock. Those buildings are still there. They haven't been torn down. They're still there providing office space for new businesses in Dublin and other cities. I'd like to talk about EU accession now as a general proposition. Remember I told you that the European Union is like a crucible for doing experiments and understanding what's happening. We see that the accession of after 1995 of the Eastern European countries, the succession of accessions that resulted, culminated now with Croatia, basically opens new opportunities for European capital to be reallocated. Okay, so again, the most obvious cases are Poland, Hungary, the Czech Republic, Slovakia. But also now you've got the Baltic countries and you've got Croatia. There are a lot of investment opportunities for entrepreneurial capitalists to move there, start businesses. Croatia is a beautiful country, huge tourist alternatives to Greece. It's a little bit chilly compared to Greece, but it's kind of a tabula rasa. You can start from scratch. So it turns out that growth and integration are definitely related. This is taken from Baldwin and Wiplow's. There's a lot of evidence that just shows that the countries that that are growing and are integrating with Europe, those are basically one and the same. So the big growth phases are associated with accession, the announcement of accession, and integration that follows. So you can see this by looking at the capital markets, which are supposed to give some sort of indicator of the profitability or the value of capital in place. So if you go back to your macro one, remember what Tobin's Q was. Tobin had this idea that a sufficient statistic of the profitability of new investment must be a ratio between the market capitalization of the existing capital stock divided by the replacement value of that same capital stock. Okay, and this Tobin's Q, it's something like the stock market. Because you can't create a company out of thin air. You have to grow it. The resources have to be brought together, especially productive equipment, but also people. So the valuation of existing assets should give us a good idea of what the market thinks is going to happen. abstracting from bubbles and the rest, this tends to be a fairly good indicator. So the logic should be that upon accession, stock markets should boom because people perceive an opportunity. They try to buy existing stock in existing companies. Because that becomes very expensive at some point, investment starts to rise. And then FDI will also improve as a consequence. Okay, so this is exactly what we observe with the accession countries, Spain and Portugal. This is, you know, sort of a, taking those three indicators and comparing them with France, which is an existing member, a long-standing member of the European Union. And you can see that this prediction is borne out quite readily. This is an index exercise. So all these numbers are basically in indexes based on 100 in 1986 for the stock market, and rates of investment and FDI for the other two panels of that diagram. Okay, so you can see that it's interesting to note that the accession is almost like the tail end of this episode. Usually it's the announcement and the preparation for the accession tends to create a lot of investment excitement and opportunity. This is a concomitant phenomenon to the investment process itself. Okay, so the last, one of the most interesting episodes of that accession sequence was actually Spain. People don't talk about the enormous success that Spain was in the 1980s when a lot of German companies and French companies went there and created not just food processing, but also automobile factories, providing lots of jobs and getting the Spanish unemployment rate quite far down in comparison with its previous history. Same thing is true for the Baltics. These are smaller countries, but also represent important investment opportunities, window to the Soviet, to the ex-Soviet Union, window to Eastern Europe in general, and you see the same sort of behavior. In contrast, in Greece we don't see this. So, you know, this tells you that either the stock markets and the financial markets are just have an enormous amount of prejudice, or maybe they understand. Maybe they understand it better than we think they do. Just maybe worth looking at. But all the same, there has, you know, it's interesting to see that you have a stock market pickup, although it's a bit lame compared to France's. Okay, so at the same time, we can also look at the performance in Germany and the countries that are sort of trading actively with it. And you can see that this is the stock of FDI, and this goes up to 2005. This is this really intensive integration episode. I'll update it in a second. You can see that there are supposed to be red bars there. Those red bars are invisible. That's the investment from Poland, Czech Republic, and Hungary in Germany. So there's nothing. You can hardly see it. Okay, there may be like two or three cases. Most of it is basically German FDI positions in those countries. It turns out that those I'm going to skip these. Those types of activities require a certain amount of, you know, common framework, and that's why it's interesting to talk in that. I'll come back and talk about the follow-up on that picture in a second. I'm going to show you that it actually is highly correlated with trade. The completion of the single market was the beginning of that episode. So the Spanish case, that Spanish boom we observed, was not just Spanish accession, but it was Spanish accession combined with the completion of the internal market, meaning that it was easier for Spanish goods and services to move across the internal boundaries, even without trade and tariffs, it's still possible to impede the flow of goods and services. And of course, the euro was introduced in 1999, 2002. That was an important step. More importantly, to make capital mobile, we need to have common banking regulations, the banking union, as it's called, and also possibly some sort of alignment of reserve requirements across banks. And of course, trying to deal with these issues of property rights and national risk. These are all things that make it, you know, interesting to ask, you know, under what conditions do German investors move their money to Poland? move their money to Hungary, even if you have a European Union that may not be enough to convince the skeptical owner of resources to move them across those boundaries. And of course, this recent financial crisis has put us a bit back, and you've seen that in the case of Ireland as well as Eastern Europe. So, you know, we can talk about the risks involving capital movements. These things can have excess. They can have excesses. You can have a bubble. We had a bubble in Ireland that was easily identified, and no one wanted to actually call it by its name, but the bubble was already identifiable in the mid-2000s. You could see this by the property values, and you know this can happen under our own noses. It can happen right here, up here in Berlin. But this leads to issues of financial instability. So banks that are involved in this type of financing of real capital movements may become shaky. There's also the risk of exchange rate volatility, because as you know, between Germany and Poland, there is an exchange rate between Hungary and Poland, and between Hungary and Germany, and the Czech Republic and Germany. So these sources of extra risk are also important. You've also got issues of excesses related to conflicting rules of law. Again, talking about the case, the cases with Ireland indicate that there's a lot of room for interpretation, how contracts are supposed to be executed in various areas. You've also got the issues of public versus private borrowing to finance capital mobility. A lot of projects are funded publicly or as a partnership. And finally, you worry about the incentives of countries to pay back their obligations. So if you do allow countries to finance capital imports using government deficits, for example, there is this issue, as we see with Southern Europe right now, whether the countries are willing to actually repay those obligations. So let me finish up by talking about this issue of FDI. So I showed you the interesting diagram of German integration with the Hungarian, Poland, and the Czech economies. A lot of this is associated with trade. So in 2 weeks, we'll talk about economic trade as a driver for integration. It's also a driver for FDI, right? So if trade is possible between two regions, it may make sense to actually produce part or all of the value added in the country with which you're trading. Best example that all of you notice every day when you have your coffee with milk and ask where that milk comes from, it's most likely now to be coming from Brandenburg, but it's also just as likely to be coming from Poland with capital that was maybe even originating in a dairy that was originally in Brandenburg. Okay, so the FDI process of moving a dairy to Poland could be coupled with the re-import or the import of the output of that factory. Okay, so we're going to it's an interesting coupling of the capital intensity of the receiver region and possibly also an increasing specialization in production that involves capital intensive goods. Okay, so we need to think about trade. We haven't thought about trade yet, but there are many different types of trade that can occur. We can have trade that's just based on pure relative efficiency. You can have trade based on relative factor allocations, so-called Heckscher-Ohlin trade. You can also think of intra-industry trade. So one of the most bizarre things I've seen is the fact that you can buy Polish beer in Berlin, right? And I bet you that a lot of that Polish beer is, and we'll find out when we go on our little trip, whether this beer is actually owned by German capitalists. It makes perfect sense. Who has the access to the technology? Who has the access to the money? It would be interesting to find out. But in any case, this is an item which you would have thought that maybe the Germans had an absolute advantage in, and I'm just saying that as an American. But actually, some people actually like Polish beer. It's kind of cool to have a bottle of Polish beer as opposed to Beck's. Everybody drinks Beck's. So this notion is that there's a third idea behind trade, which is intra-industry. You know, French people drink German wine. German people drink French wine, even though the French obviously are much better at making wine than Germans are. We'll talk about that later. But here's a nice picture. Here was the first picture I gave you. This is the increasing integration of Germany with Eastern Europe in terms of FDI positions. These are enormous amounts of money. Okay, so 35 billion euros is quite a bit, given the complete German FDI position around the world. Here's the update on that, coming up to 2010. Okay, so now we're at 50. Okay. This is the trade flows between Germany and the same countries. Okay, so you can see that exports and imports are rising, and if you layer those two on top of each other, it's amazing how similarly they move together. Of course, it may just be the general business environment, but I think there's something else going on. It's certainly a type of a marrying of trade integration and capital mobility. So Grzegorz fished out this example for us. This is a nice salient example. This is a sectoral example, looking at manufacture of cars and associated items. The dark line is the stock of FDI of Germany in those regions, those countries. And the bars are the imports and exports. It's important also to see that they move together. So what the Germans are exporting is also what they're importing, or vice versa. So a lot of this is import of inputs, and inputs are mounted or put together and they're sent back to the country of origin. Okay, thanks for your attention. I'll see you next week. We'll talk about labor mobility.